You have to give it to Sam Altman. He can make even the great and powerful Wizard of Oz blush. Altman can say something like, you can choose to deploy 5 gigawatts of compute to cure cancer, or you can choose to offer free education to everybody on Earth. He then uses the fact that he himself cannot make that moral choice as a justification for him getting his hands on 10 gigawatts of compute while leaving him under no obligation to either cure cancer or provide free education to anybody. But can we actually cure cancer with AI? Today, we will start unpacking the capabilities that an agent with artificial general intelligence, or AGI, must possess in order to find the cure for cancer and transform the medicine as we know it. Thank you for listening and subscribing. I'm Alex Chadyuk, and this is AGI. Listen every Monday morning on your favorite podcast platform. Imagine an AGI system that has a goal of finding a cure for cancer, which would be some treatment protocol combining a number of chemical agents and perhaps other physical interventions like X-ray exposure. The protocol will be a function of a large number of characteristics of the patient, like blood tests, family and personal history, and so on. But the AGI's task is not merely to generate a treatment protocol likely to have some desirable properties. It is a search through a very large number of such treatment protocols, most of which have not yet been formulated, to find those that will meet a very strict set of theoretical and practical constraints. This search is quite a bit different from the tasks given to the modern-day LLMs. It is less like planning a trip to Bora Bora for a family on a budget to see the best snorkeling spots and try the best food. It is more like planning a deployment of a self-sustaining human colony on Mars. It is a thing that nobody has ever done just like that before, and hence a thing that was most likely never seen by the model in its training set. The joint biochemistry of cancer and non-cancer tissue is a complex multidimensional space with only a narrow path that would allow you to separate one from the other completely without excessively harming the patient. Imagine playing a game of buzz wire. In this game, you have a metal loop on a handle in your hand, and you must guide it along a wire that is curving in a complicated serpentine fashion. If the metal loop touches the wire, the buzzer sounds, and you lose. Because we do not know the correct path of treatment, we're actually playing this game in complete darkness. In my example, we are finding a correct path in a three-dimensional space. In case of cancer treatment, we're dealing probably with thousands, if not millions, of dimensions, but the intuition still holds. A good way to optimize this search for such complex solution in the physical world is to start with an abstract representation of entities that seem relevant to the problem, as well as a set of causal relationship among these entities. This theoretical representation should then drive the specification of the hypotheses that will be used to verify the theory. Back to our example of playing buzz wire. The wire is long and the loop is narrow and the room is dark, so the player, trying to discover the correct path, will make very little progress by moving the loop in his hand randomly. In the real world, an incorrect treatment on a lab mouse with cancer kills the mouse. The correct treatment path for a different mouse will be different because of ever so slight variation between the two organisms. So even an immoral psychopath of a researcher cannot afford to sacrifice millions and millions of lab mice in order to train the neural net through a naive random search. Thus, starting with a good theoretical abstraction of what you're trying to do is imperative. This approach has indeed been invaluable for scientists throughout history when trying to solve complex problems. At this point, an attentive listener might invoke Richard Sutton's bitter lesson that states that whenever we try to manually engineer AI systems, they underperform in the long run in comparison to simpler systems based on more basic algorithms, because such systems scale better and can benefit from ever-growing efficiencies in compute. To this, I will say that theory generation is what we need to convert into a simple scalable algorithm if we want AGI to do any kind of frontier science. In medicine, though, there is another reason why we need a solid theory underlying the treatment protocol proposed by AGI. Unlike the Wild West of the present-day artificial intelligence, medical science does have ethics guardrails, and a clinical study testing the new treatment protocol must pass scientific review prior to being approved. AGI must be able to make its novel theories explicit and grounded in the established scientific paradigm in order to progress to empirical validation. It is probably possible to get away with mass murder of lab mice, given enough money and immoral lab assistance, but going forward with human clinical trials will be impossible without AGI being able to articulate its theory in clear scientific prose with minimal hallucinations. The next thing that we need to somehow mold into a scalable algorithm is converting a theory into a testable hypothesis. Back to our buzzwire in the darkroom. Imagine our AGI has a theory that states that the wire is a spiral. In order to test this abstract theory, AGI needs to come up with an empirical hypothesis that can be proven either true or false in practice. In our example, the empirical hypothesis would say something like this. If I hold my hand steady and go around the room in a circle with a radius of 3 feet while I'm lifting my hand up by 3 inches as I complete each circle, this will release the loop from the wire. Notice that this last statement is very different from the statement, the wire is a spiral. It is different, but it does not disagree with it. It also is practically verifiable. If I go around in the described fashion and I hear the buzz, there is something wrong with my hypothesis, so I will want to adjust it. Depending on my success with testing the adjusted hypothesis, I may grow more or less convinced in my theory. The theory of a spiral remains an abstraction that I can communicate to other scientists that can formulate their own theories on its basis, thus allowing the search for the solution to become continuous and scalable learning. My claim is that finding a cure for cancer is achievable for AGI. It needs to create novel theories of the phenomenon it researches. Hallucinations that we observe in today's large language models might actually help quite a bit. AGI will have to make its theories explicit. This is the area that requires a lot more work from the AI research community because the workings of the modern-day AI are obscure and unexplainable. Next, AGI will have to defend and justify its theories in the context of the latest established science. Here, hallucinations will hurt both its conclusions and its credibility. A lot more work is needed here. Next, AGI will have to convert its theories into testable hypotheses. World models that have been abuzz in the recent couple of weeks will be of massive help here in creating and verifying practical hypotheses that agree with the complex abstractions defined in the simulated world described by a novel theory. Next comes the hardest part. The hypotheses need to be tested in the real world, and this should be done at scale. This is where robotics comes into play, and much, much more work is needed in this field to complete the loop of continuous learning. But what we discuss today is a clear path towards the day when we will ask, what is this thing that, after 2 millennia of scientific research, solved the mystery of the emperor of diseases called cancer? And the answer will be, this is AGI.